Okay, the next topic is going to be connective tissue. If you scroll down, you're going to see right here that connective tissue is one of the most abundant tissues that we have in our body. As the name says, the main function of it is going to be to connect, right? Because that's why it's called connective tissue. As such, there are multiple different tissues that are going to be included in this category, such as you can see here, fibrous tissue, adipose tissue, cartilage, bone, and blood. If you think about the adipose tissue, we have adipose tissue, we have fat all over our body. Therefore, you can say that the adipose tissue connects everything in your body. Same thing applies to blood, for example. We have blood all over our body. Therefore, you can say that it connects all the different areas that you have in your body. Since we have all these different tissues in our body, that provides all these different functions. For example, it says binding of organs, that's the fibrous tissue. Support, that would be the bones, for example. Physical protection, that would be bones as well. Okay, immune protection, that would be the blood, right here. Okay, so then we have all these different tissues. Since we have all these tissues, you know that tissues are made of cells. So therefore, we are supposed to find multiple different type of cells. If you scroll down right here, you see cells. And you have in here fibroblasts, which are, you're gonna find it in the fibrous tissue. You have macrophages in blood, leukocytes also in blood, plasma cells also in blood. So you have all these different cells and all these different functions because of that. The one that is most important, is very important at this time, is this one right here, fibrous connective tissue. The fibrous connective tissue refers only to this type of connective tissue that is going to connect, and it has no other function but connection in between things. For example, when we talk about this tissue, we need to talk about the cell for this tissue. And the cell in this tissue is going to be the fibroblast. As the cells have the name like this, it's because these cells are going to produce fibers. So if we scroll down, we're going to see that the fibers that the fibroblasts are going to produce are going to be collagen fibers, as you can see right here, collagen fibers, elastic fibers, and reticular fibers, right here, reticular fibers, and elastic fibers. As you can understand, not all the cells in our body are exactly 2 inches by 2 inches by 2 inches, but rather they have certain shape that resemble to be like a cube, for example, but they are not exactly a cube. Therefore, when you put together these cells in your body, there's going to be multiple areas where there's going to be spaces in between because the cells are not exactly 2 by 2 by 2. These spaces are filled, and most of the spaces in your body are filled by ground substance, which is also part of the connective tissue because it connects all these different areas where there are voids or spaces in between cells or areas in your body. What is the ground substance composed of? Glycosaminoglycans, proteoglycans, right here, and adhesive glycoproteins. Okay, so that's the ground substance. Now, based on the number of fibers, remember we said that the fibrous connective tissue has fibers, you're going to have two main types. If you have just a few fibers in that tissue, that's going to be called loose connective tissue. If you have a lot of fibers, it's going to be called dense connective tissue. Let's talk about the loose connective tissue. There are two main kinds of loose connective tissue. The very first one is going to be areolar connective tissue and reticular connective tissue. So what is areolar and what is reticular? Examples of loose connective tissue. If we scroll down, we're going to see probably some figures right here. Okay, you can see here the fibers, for example, in black. See the fibers right here? There's just a few fibers because you can't even see through them. You see that? There's spaces in between them. And in here you have the areolar connective tissue because in here you can see also the fibers in red. But there's a whole bunch of spaces, right? So there's not a lot of fibers. That's why this is called loose connective tissue. Okay, so this is a type of connective tissue. If we scroll down, we're going to see the other type, which I told you is dense connective tissue. Dense connective tissue, we have two main kinds. One of them is going to be regular, and obviously the other one is going to be dense irregular. The characteristic of these things, as you can see here, dense irregular, the characteristic is that the dense regular is going to have some pattern in with respect to the fibers. Let's skip the adipose tissue for 1 second. So let's take a look at the figure for the connective. Okay, right here. So you see here reticular connective tissue. You see there is a pattern here, either from left to right or right to left. But in the case of dense irregular, it has no pattern whatsoever. But there's a lot of fibers, and here also a lot of fibers. That's why it's called dense connective tissue. Going back to this adipose tissue, right? Adipose tissue has main jobs, such as, for example, producing insulation, energy storage, okay? And there are two main kinds: the ones that adults have, adipose tissue. In this case, this is going to be white fat. That's the one that all of us have, adult people, okay? And the other one is the ones that we are born with, which is called brown fat. This is the one that newborns have. Okay, usually this fat is found at the level of the shoulders and the back, and this is again mainly in babies when they are born. So if we keep scrolling down, we have in here a figure of the fat, which we already mentioned, and now we get to cartilage. Okay, cartilage is a tissue, and like any other tissue, it's going to have cells. What cells do you have in there? Chondroblasts. Eventually, the chondroblast turns into a chondrocyte. We're going to see the figure for this in a little bit. Now, there are three kinds of cartilage. As you can see here, hyaline cartilage, elastic cartilage, and fibrocartilage. Let's scroll down. Let's see if we can find the figure for the cartilage. And right here, we have hyaline, elastic, and fibrocartilage. The next topic is going to be bone, as you can see here. Bone, you have, again, it's a tissue. Therefore, you have to know the cell. The cell is going to be the osteoblast. And the osteoblast eventually is going to turn into an osteocyte. There are two types of bones. One of them is going to be, as you can see right here, spongy bone and compact bone. Okay? So let's keep scrolling down. Let's see if we can find the figure for the bone. And we'll talk about blood in a little bit. Well, let's see. We have right here the bone. Okay, this is the structure, this concentrical structure that you have right here. See these dots? In these dots, in these black dots that you see right here, that's where the osteoblast and eventually the osteocyte is going to be found. However, this is all you need to know about the bones, because bones are very important, and that's why there's chapters coming out in this course later on where we'll cover a lot of information regarding bones. Blood, as we mentioned before, it has a whole bunch of cells and it has multiple different functions, but this is for another topic, because blood is something that you're going to see in anatomy too. If we keep scrolling down, you have a figure in there for the blood. Again, you don't have to pay much attention about it. And then that's about it for this topic. Okay, the next topic in this chapter is going to be nervous and muscular tissues. Remember, we said that we have four primary tissues: epithelial, connective, nerves, and muscle. Again, since this is tissue, you need to know the cells that you have in the nerves and cells that you have in the muscle. So the nerves in the nervous tissue is going to be the neuron as well as the neuroglia. As you can see here, neurons and neuroglia right here. Okay? That's all you need to know about the nervous tissue, because there are a few chapters coming up in this course later on where you will learn more information about this. Same thing applies to the muscles. There's chapters coming up, and that's when you're going to learn most of this information about it. At this time, you just need to know for the nervous tissue, the cells are going to be neurons and neuroglia. And for the muscular tissue, it's going to be myocyte or just muscle cell. So let's take a look at this. Right here, you have the nervous tissue. In this case, this is a cell, and this is an example of a neuron. Okay, you will learn the characteristics of the neuron later on in the other chapter. So we keep scrolling down. Cardiac muscle, as I was telling you, they're going to be called myocytes. Okay, or cardiac cells. There are three kinds of muscles. The muscles are going to be cardiac muscle, smooth muscle, and skeletal muscle. That's all you need to know for this part. Okay, and that's it for this. Okay, the next topic is cell junctions, glands, and membranes. So let's take a look at this. Cell junctions are connections in between the cells. All cells are grouped together in our body, but they are not separated. They are connected by what? By cell junctions. If we look at this figure, you can see here the cell junctions. The main cell junctions are tight junctions, desmosomes, gap junctions, and hemidesmosomes. Okay? So these cell junctions not only allows the cells to get together, but it has other functions, such as, for example, these ones look like pores, you see, right here. So it allows things to go through between cells. Other connections, for example, such as desmosomes, and they allow electricity, for example, to be transmitted from one cell to another cell. You're going to see the electricity is a very important characteristic that gives excitability to a lot of cells, such as the cells in the nerves and muscles. Okay, we're going to see that later on. So again, just to review this, which ones are the four primary junctions? They're going to be tight junctions, desmosomes, gap junctions, and hemidesmosomes. So if we keep scrolling down, We have in there tight junctions. Well, here you have a figure for the muscle, but we said we have three kinds: skeletal, cardiac, and smooth. I'm not going to mention anything else. So we keep scrolling down. The neck junction is going to be the desmosomes. Then we keep scrolling down. Next one we said gap junctions. Glands. There are two main types of glands. Those glands are going to be exocrine glands and endocrine glands. You will review endocrine glands in anatomy 2. Exocrine glands are the ones that we're going to be covering here in anatomy 1. Exocrine glands are the ones that are going to produce something, for example, sweat, and they're going to secrete this to the exterior. Since they secrete to the exterior, then they're called exocrine glands. Okay, all the exocrine glands are going to have two main parts. These two main parts are going to be an asinus and a duct. The asinus is the area where the substance is produced, for example, sweat. And the duct is the tube that takes the contents to the outside. Most of the time when we talk about outside, we are talking about the skin. Okay, so then asinus and duct. This is very important because this is the structure of most of the exocrine glands. Now, exocrine glands can be classified in multiple different ways. Unicellular, they're just made of one cell, or multicellular, multiple cells. You can see here unicellular and multicellular. An example of unicellular, for example, is goblet cells. Okay? This is not the only way that you can classify glands, by the number of cells. You can also classify them, if we can scroll down, for example, by the type of tube and the type of asinus. If the type of a sinus is, you know, like a tube like this, it's going to be tubular. If it's just one duct, it's going to be called simple. That's why this was called simple tubular. Now, if the sinus is like a balloon, it's alveolar. And if it has multiple branches, it's compound, like in this case. But that's just another type of classification. Another way you can classify the glands is in the way they secrete, the way they release the contents. For that, you have merocrine glands, apocrine glands, and holocrine glands. You can see them right here. In merocrine glands, the glands produce the contents, and they release them by exocytosis. They just open and they release the contents. In the case of apocrine glands, they produce the substance, but at the end, once they release it, parts of the cell membrane, they surround the contents, and they are released together with the parts of the cell membrane. In the case of holocrine glands, they produce the contents. Right? For example, the cell produces so much of this that the cell actually explodes. And then the contents are released with pieces of the cell that exploded. That's a holocrine gland. Okay? So if we keep scrolling down, now we need to talk about membranes. We have two main types of membranes. We have the mucous membranes, right here. And we have the serous membranes. Serous membranes right here. Serous membranes have two layers. One of them is going to be the parietal layer, and the other one is the visceral layer. In between the two layers, you're going to have a fluid. This fluid is called the serous fluid. Okay, an example of a serous membrane is, for example, the membrane that covers the heart. The particular name for that membrane is going to be the pericardium. It has two layers, as I said, parietal and visceral layer. In between, you have a fluid. And this fluid, in the case of the pericardium, is going to be called a pericardial fluid. But what type of fluid is that? It's going to be a serous fluid. Okay? So then, the other kind, as I was telling you, is going to be the mucous membrane. Mucous membranes are the ones that, membranes that cover areas that we have in our body that have contact with the exterior. For example, in our mouth. The inside of our mouth is not the same as the skin that we have in our face, because the inside of our mouth, including our lips, is going to be a mucous membrane. Not only there, but for example, in our genitals, at the level of the penis, for example, right, the inside where the urine comes out, that's a mucous membrane. Okay, in our nose, same thing. The outside is skin, but the inside is a mucous membrane. There's another membrane called cutaneous membrane. This cutaneous membrane is the one that is part of your skin. So we're going to be covering this when we cover the skin in our next chapter. So we keep scrolling down, and that's about it for this. Okay, the next topic is tissue growth, development, repair, and degeneration. This is not anatomy. Therefore, I'm not going to talk about it. You can just skip this for the purpose of your exam, because this is not normal anatomy. So I'm just going to skip this, and that's it.